Welcome to Nightcap. I'm John Sarlin. We got a great show for you today. First up, well, they all didn't make it. The long-anticipated crypto crackdown is here. Then, the PGA Tour accused of hypocrisy after partnering with LIV Golf. But is golf just the beginning of the Saudi sports takeover? And last, the hotly contested remote work debate. Is the battle to work from home entering a new era? But first, a big blow to the crypto bros. In the span of 24 hours this week, the SEC filed a pair of scathing lawsuits against two of the world's biggest crypto companies. The SEC accuses Binance and Coinbase of operating illegal security exchanges in the United States. Now, the government says the companies are facilitating the buying and selling of crypto assets without registering as securities brokers, which means consumers don't get the same protections as when they buy stocks and bonds. But both companies are pushing back. Coinbase CEO Brian Armstrong says the SEC approved its business when it allowed it to go public in 2021. He also says there is no, quote, path to come in and register, and that they tried to do it repeatedly. Now, Binance, which is also accused of illegally commingling customer funds, says it respectfully disagrees with the SEC's allegations and says it's become a target because of its size and global name recognition. Now, the lawsuits could take months, if not years, to resolve. But is this truly, actually, maybe the end for crypto? Let's bring in CNN's Allison Morrow to discuss. Allison, you know, we've seen the so-called death of crypto proclaimed over and over again, but this is a very big deal. Two actions by the SEC in 2 days targeting Binance and Coinbase. They are the two most important players left in the space. Do you think these two companies can survive these suits?
Thanks for having me on, John. Yeah, I mean, we've seen a lot of turmoil in the crypto space, especially in the past year. But I think these companies can survive. It's just a matter of whether they can survive in the United States. It's not the death of crypto, but it may be kind of a medically induced coma, at least in the United States. In this jurisdiction, the SEC has made it very clear that it's not really into what they're selling, you know, and it may not tolerate it. So that is pushing a lot of crypto companies to look overseas at friendlier jurisdictions that are already, you know, putting in place regulatory structure so that they can have a clearer path to a legitimate business. The United States is just a lot stricter, and it's a lot more difficult environment to do that.
Well, let's talk about one of those companies in a perhaps medically induced coma, Binance. In the suit, a line got a lot of attention. Now, this is from the chief compliance officer in 2018. Quote, "We are operating as an effing unlicensed security exchange in the USA, bro." I mean, that's not great if your chief compliance officer says that. So, I mean, what do you think that says about crypto? That this was the chief compliance officer of one of the largest crypto companies, and he said this in writing.
It's not great. Listen, you know, bro, what are you going to do? It's right there in writing. And I think that on a serious note, that speaks to kind of this bigger problem that crypto has always had, which is that its very core ethos is anti-establishment, anti-government, and it creates this kind of righteousness, this attitude of, among its, you know, most devout people that we're above the law or we're doing God's work. And this is like, no one can touch us. So they do these kind of things that are, you know, most business people would tell you are really irresponsible. Like, if you're going to do crimes, don't put it in writing. But that's what they did. So we'll see how that plays out.
I think if you took a photo of the SEC investigator when he found that quote, I think you could probably sell that as an NFT, make a lot of money. So the SEC has accused Coinbase of never registering with the SEC. Now, Coinbase is arguing that they tried to do it. What does this come down to?
Yeah, again, it's just that the SEC, I think, is ghosting on these crypto companies that are actually trying to do the right thing. And, you know, to Coinbase's credit, I do think it's important to distinguish Coinbase and Binance. Coinbase is a U.S. publicly traded company. It has a team of lawyers who have been working with the SEC and trying to do the right thing, at least according to its CEO, Brian Armstrong. So, you know, I think crypto's or Coinbase is trying to do the right thing, but the SEC is kind of leaving it in the lurch, in part because Gary Gensler, you know, the head of the SEC, said earlier this week, we don't need any more digital dollars. Or digital currencies. We've got the U.S. dollar. Thank you very much. So I think that, you know, ultimately Coinbase is resigning itself to figuring this out in court, because remember, the SEC can't make the law, it can only enforce the law, and it needs an act of Congress. And I think only a judicial review at this point is going to get that for Coinbase.
Up next, a deal that has rocked the sports world and has implications way beyond it. The US-based PGA Tour is set to partner with Saudi-backed Live Golf. Now, a bitter dispute between the two golf leagues had been raging for the past year. The PGA banned golfers like Phil Mickelson, who signed up for big money with the Saudi League and pressured other golfers to turn down huge Live paydays. The PGA Tour execs called out Saudi Arabia for its human rights record and even suggested Live golfers were betraying victims of the 9/11 attacks. But then a shocking turn of events. The PGA Tour, DP World Tour, and LIV Golf will combine into a new entity backed by a new investment from Saudi Arabia's Public Investment Fund. Just don't call it a merger. A PGA Tour spokesperson tells CNN this is a, quote, partnership slash creation of a new commercial entity, not a merger. Here to discuss is USA Today columnist and CNN contributor Christine Brennan. So, Christine Brennan, some PGA players feel like they were betrayed by this. So do some 9/11 families. PGA Tour Commissioner Jay Monahan said he recognizes that some people will call him a hypocrite. Is there any other way to look at this other than the money one?
Or a complete betrayal of everyone's values, which is maybe not entirely insignificant. Although, John, great to be with you. Certainly the money talks, and it's the kind of money from the Saudis is so extraordinary. They reportedly offered Tiger Woods close to $1 billion to leap to the to LIV Golf. Tiger said no, admirably said no. And I'll call it a merger, by the way. I'll say merger all the time. I mean, let's call this what it is. It's a complete capitulation by the PGA Tour and by their commissioner, Jay Monahan, to be in business with, according to the United Nations, according to various intelligence sources, with the people who killed and dismembered Jamal Khashoggi, the Washington Post columnist. Now, they deny that, of course, the Saudis do, and Mohammed bin Salman, but that's what we're talking about. And if that's not enough, there, of course, are the omnipresent human rights violations that we certainly know about involving women, LGBTQ people in Saudi Arabia. The fact that now they've got such a foothold in a U.S. sport and worldwide sport, both the European, Old European Tour and the U.S. Tour, John, it's appalling. It's alarming. It's reprehensible. Everyone should be saying, what in the world is going on? The sellout is extraordinary.
Yeah, I mean, this is clearly a huge victory for Saudi Arabia, who seem to have won the skirmish. And let me ask you this, which is, you know, golf isn't the only sport where Saudi Arabia has been expanding its influence. Its sovereign wealth fund also bought the Newcastle United soccer club in the Premier League. The Saudi Soccer League has recruited Cristiano Ronaldo and Karim Benzema. Do you see the Saudi investment fund going after more American franchises next? Is this the new playbook?
Certainly could be. I think right now everyone's trying to digest this over the last few days and what it means. A hypothetical, it's not going to happen. The WNBA, we know because of Brittany Griner and her imprisonment, the money, the lack of, you know, the salaries, just a fraction, a tiny fraction. Women make 200,000 at most in a WNBA season, 250,000. And the top NBA players are making over $40 million. It won't happen, I'm sure, because the WNBA would have scruples and would say, we're not doing this. And they would have values and they would hate to be in business with such a terrible regime as the Saudis. But just a drop in the bucket in terms of Saudi money would be life altering for every WNBA player, would change the landscape forever. So this is the conundrum. This is the conversation. This is where we are all headed as we start to envision a world where the Saudis get, and their blood money, in my opinion, get to, and the sports washing issue, of course, this is the game, the playpen now they're in, the playground that they're now in. And so certainly their inroads, as you mentioned, in soccer, men's soccer, women's sports, women's golf, the LPGA Tour, is that next? And would those players put up a stand? I doubt it. They'd probably say, sure, give us the money, because they are such in a weaker financial position, of course, than men's golf. There would be something like tennis. There's another example where you could see trying to make inroads. The backlash, I think, is a significant thing here. From my reporting and writing and talking about this, others, it has been almost unanimously negative. And so there is that piece of it, the PR nightmare that now is happening and enveloped the PGA Tour. So throw that out in the mix. And I think the answer is let's wait and see over the next few months and, year, and even into the next couple of years.
And last, it seems like every day, another very rich corporate titan adds their name to the list of work from home critics. The latest, Martha Stewart. In a magazine interview, she slammed hybrid work, saying people can't, quote, possibly get everything done working 3 days a week in the office and 2 days remotely. And she suggested America will, quote, go down the drain if people don't return to the office. Now, Stewart is hardly the only one. Bank CEOs like Jamie Dimon and tech CEOs like Elon Musk and Sam Altman have also criticized working from home. But at the same time, many employees don't want to give up the flexibility of hybrid culture. So, how will this battle play out? Here to discuss is Dan Kaplan, a senior client partner at Korn Ferry, one of the world's largest recruiting firms. Dan, okay, so Martha Stewart is now trash-talking work from home, and Google is reportedly telling workers not coming to the office enough that they could that could show up on their performance reviews. Does it feel like the tide is turning against hybrid work over the last few weeks?
There's no question that the tide is turning. I do think, John, what we've experienced has been some inertia. CEO, it's a very complex issue. Most CEOs look at work from home. Originally, it was in, because of COVID. It's become a bit of an entitlement after 3 years now. But they look at it and they see an erosion of corporate culture, an erosion of innovation, an erosion of collaboration. They see less mentorship of young professionals. Many organizations see younger professionals coming into the office, and the more senior folks who should be leading and mentoring aren't there. And so they've been looking to tackle this and bring people back. And frankly, they didn't have much leverage. And everyone thought the economy, and in large part, they thought we'd be in recession. They thought the job numbers would give the C-suite the leverage to bring people back. And that hasn't happened. And so there's been inertia kind of waiting for that leverage. And it does seem like in the last couple of months, those conversations have been intensifying. And in fact, now companies are pushing hard to get people back.
Well, let's talk about that leverage, because some workers are not quietly going into the night on this, right? So last week, Amazon corporate workers walked off the job to protest return to work policies, among other issues. And the Wall Street Journal also reports that there's a revolt at insurance company Farmers Group because the new CEO wants workers in the office 3 days a week. What kind of leverage do workers have here when it comes to working from home at this point?
It's really complicated. Some have leverage, and we've seen some organizations, and we have been living for the last 3 years in a time of employee activism in a way that we haven't seen since the early days of unionization. And so we have seen some organizations, even white collar engineering organizations, where they've looked to unionize. We have seen employees band together. We also, John, have been living through what we see as an epidemic of quiet quitting and quiet retiring. And so even though surveys show that 72% of people will take a job, even if they're not necessarily ready to quit tomorrow, they will take a job for less money if they're able to have flexibility. And so it's going to make recruiting harder. And 70% of companies still plan on adding headcount this year. And so we're not in a frozen recessionary labor market. You will see people can vote with their feet if they will and change jobs. You'll see people quiet quitting, which can be the death knell of an organization where people have no choice, so they come into work, but they're not inspired. Every CEO has this almost dream of having their employees act like owners, where they make decisions as a fiduciary for the company, and you lose that. And all of the trust that was engendered during the first few years of COVID, when people didn't trust government, they didn't trust sources of information, they trusted their company, CEOs were seen as empathetic. That's losing. A recent survey of 3,000 CHROs showed a full third said their CEO demonstrates zero empathy. And so even if tomorrow people aren't going to walk out the job and quit, they're going to make decisions when they look for a new job. They're going to disengage. They're not going to bring their full self to work. And ultimately, it's going to hurt companies that don't continue to offer some degree of flexibility because people feel like it was promised to them. They've got used to it. They've reassessed their life, their priorities, and they're not going to give it up without a fight, for sure. They're going to find whatever leverage they can.
So that's all from us. Don't forget to sign up for the Nightcap newsletter at cnn.com/nightcap. And join us again next week at 4 p.m. Eastern right here at CNN Business. Thanks for watching.